All right, here we go. So I want to show you a video. We've been talking about the open source nature of our of the tool, and we'll hit on that a little bit more. This is not something that was created by us, but I think this will be helpful for you. This video is called Three Circles in 3 Minutes. All right, Three Circles in 3 Minutes.
Has anyone showed you the three circles before?
Have you heard of
three circles before?
Has anyone ever shared
the three circles with you
before?
No.
No.
So this is the first circle. So this represents the world that's broken.
All of us live in a broken world.
You only have to turn on the news and see
suffering, death,
war, sickness,
rape, disease. It's everywhere, right?
But you know, God didn't actually create the world to be like this, full of brokenness, eh? Here's the second circle.
This circle represents God's perfect design.
God's perfect design was a world without brokenness.
A world full of love.
Full of joy and peace, yeah, and unity.
But what we did was we sinned.
Sin could be anything from lying to murder.
Wait, so like just like normal lying or like hard lying?
And what sin did, it separated us from God's perfect design and threw us into brokenness.
And so people try all kinds of different things to get out of brokenness. They might try drugs or alcohol.
Or maybe chasing a career or money.
Smoking.
Even bullying other people at school.
Oh, sleeping suicide. Around. Suicide, exactly, a good example. But it doesn't actually fix the problem of brokenness.
It's like a bungee cord. We just get snapped straight back into brokenness.
And ultimately, if people die in that state of brokenness, they're separated from God, and that means that that's eternal separation from God.
Do you know what this place is often called? Yes.
So what God did was, he didn't want to leave us in that place.
God loved us so much that he sent
his son Jesus to die on the cross.
Jesus was God, so yeah, he had no sin. And when he died and rose again, he actually took on all of our sin and canceled it, like he crushed it.
He said if we would turn away from our sin and believe in Jesus and make Jesus
the Lord of our life, we become restored
back into God's original design.
And you become a new creation, a new person in Christ.
And will restore us back into relationship with him. So there's only two kinds of people in this world, people that are in brokenness or God's perfect design. Where would you see yourself?
Probably right there, to be honest.
In this circle.
I'm not sure.
Love?
Brokenness?
Yeah, possibly love.
The bungee stage.
Yeah, the same.
And where would you
like to be?
So where would you like to be? You'd like to be here?
Yeah. Yeah.
Right there.
Yeah. Give me a look.
One with God.
So here? So is there anything that's stopping you
from turning and believing in Jesus?
And allow him to be Lord and King of your life?
Stubbornness?
Probably not.
Probably we, to be honest.
Nothing's stopping me.
You know the awesome news about Jesus? He is the only way out.
If you try to clean yourself up before coming to Jesus, it's like trying to get clean before you take a shower.
Oh, I see, yeah, I get that.
Is there anything stopping you?
We shared the three circles with 34 people. 4 were already believers. 13 chose to remain in brokenness, but some were deeply impacted. And 17 wanted to leave brokenness and receive Christ. There are many powerful ways to share the gospel, and the three circles is a great place to start.
You're encouraged by that, seeing children, seeing teenagers, seeing adults use that tool. If that's a video that you want to utilize, we didn't create it, but it's been viewed a ton of times on YouTube. If you just search three circles in 3 minutes, that might be helpful to you. I know a lot of you were watching that and thinking, man, I think more people would accept Christ and receive Jesus as their Lord and Savior if I had an Australian accent. That's what I think about every time I watch that. And so I can do it in an Indian accent, but I cannot do it in an Australian accent. So anyway, I do think one of the things that has been an encouragement to me, Jimmy, is that it is such an open source thing. And I think that, like, to come in our world and what we do to be able to encourage the EPC. So I know that's a big part of the puzzle for you. Jimmy on?
How are we doing back there? We're back. And we're back. All right, well, one of the cool things about the three circles that we decided to do, so years ago we developed this tool, at our church. And again, we developed it talking to people who are far from God. We have a very multicultural environment. Barna Research said that West Palm Beach, Florida has the highest percentage of never churched people of any municipality in the nation, which I find that hard to believe, but that's what they said. And so we're trying to have these conversations with people who just don't have a lot of background in Christianity. But what I've also found is that in South Florida, at least, people are not generally hostile towards the gospel. They're just not thinking God thoughts. They're not, it's not that they're mad about it, they're just not that interested in it and don't have a lot of awareness of it, and it doesn't seem to connect with their life, which is one of the reasons why when someone's experiencing brokenness, what happens is the way that God made the universe is he made the universe so that there are moral laws that govern the universe, just like there are physical laws that govern the universe. So when people break God's moral laws, they experience the moral consequences, such as guilt and shame and pain and difficulty and all the things that happen. And when that's happening, they recognize something's wrong, which is why that gives you the entree to begin to have a gospel conversation and present to them maybe a framework for understanding what is going wrong in their lives that they've never considered before. One of the things we figured out as we were doing that is we started doing this intuitive circles and arrows kind of thing. There's an organization that we work with in Baptist life called the North American Mission Board, and they plant about 800 or 900 churches every year, especially in major cities around the country. And the North American Mission Board said, hey, we need a tool to train our church planters and our churches with, and we're going to use the three circles. They'd heard of it. And so they kind of mass marketed it. And that's when we printed the book, and that's when they made an app we'll talk about it in a little bit, and they've got all kinds of tools. We got these, you know, our teenagers and all, we use these rubber bracelets and all this kind of stuff that we use to try to keep it in front of people. But one of the things that we decided a long time ago was that no one was going to make money off of the three circles. So one of the things that we did when we started all this is we said, hey, look, we're just going to give the three circles away to everybody and anybody. And our only appeal is that if someone uses the three circles, we ask them not to charge for the tool other than the actual cost of the materials for reproduction. And that's what we've asked people to do. And as far as I know, around the world. So people have picked it up around the world. It's also an open source tool. So again, people, you know, I like to draw this on a napkin. That's my favorite place to draw it, at a restaurant or even in my office, a coffee napkin or whatever. And so when people say to me, well, hey, like was just said a second ago, like, you know, I prefer a different word for this, or I prefer it. It doesn't matter. It's your napkin. It's your conversation. You're the one having the conversation. You're the one sharing the gospel. I don't want you to feel bound by anything. So it's an open source tool, which is why people call me all the time. They'll, in, you know, Pakistan, or I saw somebody send me a picture the other day of somebody who was in Africa, and they were sharing the three circles with a witch doctor, and they were drawing the circles in the dirt in Africa. And so it's an open source tool. You do the tool in the way that you want to do it, but I think it's still a helpful map. It's a way for you to get started. So some of you are going to say, like, I think you saw the way those guys did it. They had those little pictures, and they drew a heart, and they drew a crown, and those kinds of things. That's a group called No Place Left. And this group called No Place Left trains people in evangelism discipleship all over the world. And they asked me if they could take the three circles and make that their tool, and they have. But they've kind of rebranded it. They've done it their own way, which is awesome. That's what an open source tool is for. And so we have people, so that's why, can the EPC use it? Absolutely. Can you use it at your church? Yes. Can we put it on a t-shirt? Yes. Can I put it on a hat? Yes. Don't call me. Don't email me. You can do it. Okay, just do it. Can we translate this into Russian and use it? Yes. Yes, you can. Can we change the word to it? Yes. Whatever. If it helps you, use it and make it your own. I do ask that you don't personally profit off of it. Just if you have to charge for something, if you have to put it on a hat, charge for the cost of the hat. You know what I'm saying? Charge for the cost of the booklet that you made, and then do whatever you want. And I love that. And the reason I really like that too for a group like the EPC is you have innovators all the time. If we'll make it open source, then innovators can innovate and make it better. And so I've learned a lot of things about training on the three circles and presenting the three circles that have helped me a lot just by being around other innovators and them telling me the things that they're doing and the things that they're learning as they're training people. And so I don't, the last thing I want you to feel is bound, like, oh my gosh, well, I saw Jimmy do it and he said it this way and I don't know if I really want to say it that way. Say it your way. It doesn't matter. Be like Burger King. Do it your way, right? Some of you guys are old enough to remember that. Do it how you want, but do it. Throw your net out. Throw your net out one more time and do it in the way that God's equipped you to do it. I think that's really important. And to that event, so the number four on our little notes, one of the only ways that you can actually make use of the gospel is you have to actually engage with far from God people. This is really hard for pastors to do. Now, the pastors in the room are going, it's not hard for me to do. That's because you probably have little kids. When you have little kids, easy to do. Because you're constantly in the car line, at the ball practice, at the ballet. You're constantly with all these people, and you're in this churn with these people that you have to work in the concession stand with, and you go on a little trip with, and you do whatever. But what happens is, as your family gets older, as you get older, as you get more entrenched in your community, you know that there's this gravitational pull for pastors away from far from God people. And the same thing happens to your people in your church. The longer they're a Christian, there's this pull. And it's not all wrong. We build our community, our closest relationships, our family is our church. And yet, how are we going to do the task of evangelism? So I just encourage everybody, if you are not already doing that, find a way that gets you outside of your bubble and forces you into other relationships. Well, how would I do that? I don't know. Join a club. What kind of club? Any club. Join the Rocket Club. There's a Rocket Club in your town. There's people. They're nerdy. They go out in the country and shoot up rockets. They'll love to teach you how to do it. Join the Photography Club, the Bird Watching Club, the Running Club, the Walking Club. Some of you guys are CrossFitters. Go do CrossFit. That's a great way to make friends. And you know how you can tell if somebody does CrossFit? They'll tell you. That's how you know. And so you go make a friend, do what you have to do, but if you don't have a strategy for engaging with far from God people, it's going to be really challenging for you to model this for people. And so I'd really encourage you to encourage your people to do it and model that for them.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's huge for as you're training this, to be able to have personal experience to encourage your people with. And the reality is, a lot of the people in our churches every day at work or in their neighborhood are engaged with far from God people. So what you're going to hopefully do is model and show them how they can turn an everyday conversation into a gospel conversation. The next thing on your sheet is emphasize rapid obedience. And the reason why we just want to highlight this is because I don't know what you've experienced in your churches, but I'll tell you what I've seen a lot. Here's what the normal spiritual growth track looks like in a lot of our churches across America. When you become a Christian, you get involved in the church. Then, after several years of sitting in Bible studies and soaking in Bible teaching and all that, somebody twists their arm to take an evangelism class. All right, then after that, then we'll follow up a couple times a year with sermons on evangelism that make our people feel bad for not being evangelistic, right? This is kind of like the normal thing that a lot of our churches do, and it's dumb, all right? There's my theological word for it. That's dumb. I actually think what we should do is teach and train new believers quickly to have these kinds of conversations with their friends. That might mean you've got to go with them to have the conversation and help them with it the first couple of times they do it. But I would emphasize rapid obedience. If you have someone in your church that you share this with, someone in your neighborhood, and you share this with them, and you're like, oh, they're actually already a Christian, then the conversation you can have with them is, hey, who's somebody next week that me and you can introduce this idea to? We got a friend that we can take out to lunch. Who else in our neighborhood can we have this conversation with? So I think the important thing here is, like, I know a lot of us, we want theological correctness. We want people to be theologically deep, and we want to train them in theological things. I hope that you'll consider that using a gospel tool like this is actually an entry-level beginner theology class for the people that you are trying to send out with the Great Commission to go do the work of the evangelist. And so emphasize rapid obedience. I get that might take some untraining for a lot of us, right? Like, we got to figure out, hey, let's do this. Let's get everybody on the same page, and let's go tackle this. But I would emphasize rapid obedience. The next thing is coordinating the air war and the ground war. And the way that we look at this, if you kind of like want to, how do I summarize what the air war is and what the ground war is? The air war is your preaching, your events, your themes, the big picture things that happen in your church, right? So what I would encourage, how many senior pastors, primary teaching pastors are in the room? Raise your hand. Okay, that's awesome. A bunch of you. Here's what I would encourage you to do. I would encourage you to infuse evangelism into your preaching, your events, and your themes throughout the year. In fact, we're in the middle. We made a bold decision this year. We just spent the last 20-something weeks in the book of Revelation with all of our people. That's a bold decision, all right? Yeah, when we have no idea what we're talking about. It's a bold decision. So we get to Revelation 21 this past week, and we're talking about all this stuff, like, wow, God's design. God's making all things new. This is like a really beautiful picture. So you know what all of our preaching and teaching pastors did on stage? We had whiteboards on stage, and they taught Revelation 21 with that lens to help people understand how Jesus is making all things new, and we are invited to be a part of that process. And what did that do? Man, we just coordinated the air war and the ground war from our stage to thousands of people that week. They all were reminded of how important it is to have a simple way to talk about the gospel. Pastor Jimmy, how would you summarize for people the ground war and how those two things can kind of mesh?
Yeah, so the ground war is more your programs, your Bible studies. It's what you're doing with kids. It's what you're doing with students. So it's your week-to-week programming outside of the general worship service, the gathered church. And the reason that's important is sometimes you'll have a youth pastor who's just on fire for God. So he's got, or you know, all the teenagers are all cranked up about it. But it's not coordinated with the air war. It's not supported from the pulpit. It's not supported with the themes. It's not supported with the big programs of the church. And so you just have one guy out here spinning and doing a good job with evangelism, and everybody's real proud of him, but it's really not coordinated. And a better battle plan is to coordinate the air war and the ground war so that what's happening in terms of your themes and your programs and your preaching and your teaching and your training and your mission trips and your camps and all the stuff that you're doing, it ought to be coordinated with the air war. And that really comes down to the senior pastor, the lead pastor, the teaching pastor. I don't know how your church is structured, but however it is, it really comes down to whoever is the decision maker on the themes and the sermons and the big ideas for the church has to be coordinated with people who are actually at the grassroots with the people on a basis outside of the gathered worship. And if those two things are coordinated, you have a much more effective plan. I was just talking to a brother over here who's an ex-Baptist and an ex-Marine, recovering from both, I'm sure. But he was telling me that he likes how the Bible uses battle imagery. And I think that's true, and I think that's really helpful. You know that if you have an air war, you can bomb somebody into oblivion, but if you want to take a city, eventually somebody's got to go in on the ground and go house to house. And you can take a city without air cover and air support, but it's a lot harder. And so what you really want is an air war and a ground war that are coordinated together, and that's how you take ground more efficiently and do a better job. So I'd encourage you to consider that as you plan your evangelism training.
Yeah, you can't just preach your church into being
nope.
more evangelistic. You gotta
preach it and you program it.
You preach it and you program it. And that's why, and we'll camp on this for a minute, we think it's really important that you create bottleneck conversations. You create bottleneck conversations. All right, so what is a bottleneck conversation? You probably have a bunch of them in your church already, but let me just tell you what those are and how that goes along with coordinating the air war and the ground war. Bottleneck conversations are the regular rhythms of your church life. They are the speed bumps that you have in place or need to put in place to where you can have more of these. This is the evangelistic church culture component. Like, you want to train people to do this outside of the church when they go and wherever they live and work and play, but when it comes to your church being evangelistic in your neighborhood, here's how you do it. And this is what we think has helped us. And these bottlenecks are those regular rhythm things that happen in your church. For us, there's something that happens the first Sunday of every month. It's called First Connection. First Connection, we invite every guest or new attender of our church to attend. How many of you have some kind of new members, pastor's coffee, come hang out with the staff, something that happens somewhat regularly at your church. So a lot of us do. If you don't, I would encourage you to do something. Because a lot of these people that might walk through our doors, whether they're young Christians, seasoned Christians, or just stumbled into your church doors, they want to get to know you, and they want to hear about what is important and what the church is doing. And you know what happens at First Connection every single first Sunday of the month? We walk through the three circles. It's a speed bump. It's part of our pathway to membership. That means nobody can become a member at Family Church if they don't go through First Connection. So it's a speed bump. They got to go. They got to sit there with us. They talk about the gospel with us. We walk them through it. We invite them to respond if they haven't already. It's a speed bump. There's a couple of other speed bumps. Like we have baptism classes. I get it. That's one of our primary distinctions between our denominations. But when somebody has a question about getting baptized and why we celebrate baptism and all that, that's another speed bump. You know what happens in our baptism classes? We start drawing circles. Our kids ministry does something that I think is so valuable. When any kid completes the second grade, they're invited to attend something called the Kids New Believers class. And the Kids New Believers class is like a First Connection, but for kids, where we talk about the basics of Christianity and how God has made them to pursue Him. And you know what we do with all of those kids? Every third grader through fifth grader that comes through that class, you know what happens? They learn how to share the three circles. We teach them it. They figure out where they are in it. A lot of times we have baptism conversations that come out of that. But when they walk out of that Kids New Believers class, those kids are not just able, like they're not just able to recognize what the three circles are. Every kid that goes through that class has drawn that back out for their parent. Here's the other thing that's awesome about that bottleneck. You know who has to attend Kids New Believers class? One of the parents. I'll tell you, this past year, just at Family Church Sherbrooke, where I'm the pastor, we have baptized three adults who sat with their kid at Kids New Believers class. Three adults who sat there where their kids were learning about it. We have follow-up meetings. I remember the one mom sitting at Panera with our kids ministry director. I'm sitting at another table and I'm just listening. I'm like, what's happening over there? And I realized the mom said, hey, I think I'm in that circle that you drew out called brokenness where you're telling my daughter about it. Can we meet up and talk about it? She starts talking about her marriage. Leads to a gospel conversation. She repents and believes in Jesus. We baptized her in the ocean. It was awesome. But it's a bottleneck. Listen, I'm not saying you have to adopt our bottleneck conversations, but you all are equipped to create some speed bumps in your church where this can just become a regular part of the rhythms of your church life. Now, you look at this tool, and you might be thinking, huh, these three circles, that's a really cool evangelism tool. Must have just like formed just like the four spiritual laws or all this other stuff. The three circles actually came as a bottleneck, and I think it's a pretty unique story. So I would love for you to explain, Jimmy, about a marriage mentoring conversation you had and where all of this stuff started.
Yeah. So when we came up with the three circles, we didn't sit around thinking, how can we come up with a way of sharing the gospel? What actually happened when I moved to South Florida, I'd been a dean at the seminary in Louisville, then I'd been a teaching pastor at a large multi-site church there. But it was my first time being a senior pastor. And when I got to our church had a lot of problems. They had a lot of scandals and financial problems and dilapidated facilities. And so our church hadn't had a pastor in 5 years because they couldn't get anybody to take the job. And so finally the church called me to come be their pastor. And just as an aside, if a church ever calls you after they haven't had a pastor for 5 years, be sure you are not at the top of the original search list, guys. So they eventually called me. I come down there to be the pastor, and the church was aging. It was an aging congregation. Nothing wrong with that, except for if you're not reaching young people and young families, your church is dying. So I said, we've got to figure out a way to reach some younger families. Well, when I was in Louisville at the seminary, my wife and I had this huge ministry with young couples, people who were getting married, like preparation for marriage kind of stuff, young couples, young parents, because by then we'd been married like 8 or 9 years and we knew everything, so we were able to talk about it really authoritatively. And so and isn't that crazy? You know, when I was 25 years old, I was a youth pastor, and parents would come, and those parents were so dumb, they would ask me for parenting advice. And I was so dumb, I gave it to them, which was dumber. But anyway, we're doing this ministry. So when we got to West Palm Beach, I said, hey, all we've got to do is let's just start rolling out our kind of young couples deal, and we'll get a bunch of kids that maybe they go to Palm Beach Atlantic University. It's a Christian university there. We'll get some young people to come, and we'll just start, you know, pouring into them like we always have. And we'll get our Paul trip material and get it all organized and share it with them. And so we advertised preparation for marriage class, Jimmy and Kristen Scroggins, $40 for materials, 8 couples limited. Thing filled up in one day. Put it in the church bulletin, filled up one day. I said, here we go, we're off to the races. We're going to start reaching young couples like gangbusters. We show up on Wednesday night. We've got our Paul Tripp stack of books. We're going to give all of them. We're ready to unload gospel-centered marriage-type conversations. And they show up, and it's not who I thought we were going to see. Almost all seven of the 8 couples were in their 30s and 40s. All of them were living together. All of them had children. None of them were married. None of them were Christians. Someone else in their family had signed them up for the class. And then I had this one little couple, 23 and 22, dating, mating, and waiting. You know, they're sitting there just ready to go. I said, well, let's go around and everybody tell what made you want to come to the class. Girl sitting to my right, she said, my name's Katie. She's an Anglo girl, huge with child. So my name's Katie. I have 2 children from 2 previous relationships. I've never been married. I'm here with my boyfriend, Jorge. We've been living together for the last 6 or 7 months. We're going to have a baby together. We're thinking about getting married. My aunt goes to your church. She signed us up for this class. I hope it helps. I said, that's great, Katie. I'm glad to have you. How about you, Jorge? What's your story? No hablo inglés. Okay. Well, Katie, you know, since y'all are so close, can you just kind of translate for Jorge and let's try to tell me a little bit of... She said, oh, I don't speak a word of Spanish. I'm not making this up. So she didn't speak any Spanish and he didn't speak any English, but they had been communicating. You know what I mean? All right. Let's just go on. Sitting next to Jorge was a girl named Priscilla. Now, she was a beautiful girl, and she's Puerto Rican, which was really fortunate because then she could help me with Jorge. And so Priscilla, thick Puerto Rican accent, but super sharp, had her MBA on the fast track with a bank down there in South Florida. She was over about 30 branch banks. She was on the fast track. She also was great with child. She had been divorced. She had a child from her first marriage. She was there with her boyfriend, Stanley. Stanley was a Jamaican ex-NFL football player who owns his own business in West Palm. He has a son that he adopted from his sister when she got murdered. And so I found out pretty quick that Priscilla and Stanley had met in the Walmart parking lot, immediately moved in together, and here we were. And she had never been inside of a church building until this conversation I'm describing for you right now, because she was raised Buddhist in Puerto Rico. And Stanley had been raised by Christian parents, but had not been active with his faith since he was in college. We started going around. It was just one thing after that. It was unbelievable. We got to the end, and it dawns on me. You can take all this Paul Tripp stuff and just... Because these people don't know Bible verses. They don't know Bible stories. They don't have any Christian commitments. They don't have a Christian worldview. So me trying to explain to them how the gospel really applies to marriage is important. But we've got to find some way to talk to them about marriage, because I can't bait and switch them. That's why they signed up for the class. But what they really need is Jesus. So how am I going to talk to them about Jesus using marriage as the vehicle to point people to Jesus? Wouldn't that be unique if a Christian used marriage to show people Jesus? I'm glad I came up with that. So what we did, we dismissed the class, and then we went back and we started working on a way to talk about marriage and Jesus without requiring people to know a lot of Bible verses and Bible stories. And that's how we came up with the 3 circles. God has a design for your marriage, your sex life, your parenting. We've departed from God's design, and that's why we've experienced all this brokenness. When we're broken, we're always trying to find a way out of our brokenness, a way to fix our brokenness, but it never works. We realize something outside of us has to happen. It's the good news of Jesus Christ. And we receive Jesus by faith and turn from our sins, acknowledge our sins, then Jesus comes into our lives, forgives our sins, begins to heal the broken places in our lives, and helps us begin to recover and pursue God's design the best we can from right here, right now. What's God's design for gender and sexuality and family structure? Well, God's design is save yourself for marriage, marry another Christian, build your family on Christ, one man, one woman for life. How's Katie going to get there? Right here. Because God has the ability via the gospel, that is the gospel, to heal the broken places in our lives and allows us, doesn't erase our past, but gives us a new beginning so we can begin to recover and pursue God's design from where we are right now. The bigger the brokenness, the longer the journey. But we have a big God with a powerful gospel. And that's why we can use tools like this to find far from God people like that. And the reason these people are in the room, and there's this conversation I'm describing, is because we stumbled into this thing we've called bottleneck conversations. These are regular conversations that people already want to have. I don't have to convince them to have it. Let me give you another example that may strike closer to home for you. So we're Baptists, so you know we don't baptize babies. But people come to my church all the time that have some kind of a Catholic background or something. They'll show up and they'll go, hey, we have a new baby. We'd like you to baptize our baby. And I always say, well, you know, we actually don't baptize babies at family church, but we do something that I think might be meaningful for you. We have a ceremony we call parent-child dedication. And so I'm not trying to have a theological, I'm just telling you how bottleneck conversations work. You do you. And so I say, just forgive me. Just God's family's big. So I say, look, come on, and we want you to come to this class that'll tell you more about what we mean. And when they get to the class, what are we going to talk about? We're going to talk to the mom and or the dad about Jesus. And why? I didn't have to persuade them to do anything. There's something they kind of instinctively or traditionally know they want to do. But what they really need is not for me to do something to their baby. What they really need is for God to do something to their heart. And if God will do that, so we work on that. So we have a class. The new believers class for kids is important because Baptists, we want to baptize our kids too, okay? We just do it later. And so we have these kids that come, and we don't allow them to be baptized until after they've completed the second grade. And after they complete the second grade, the parents want them to be baptized. It's amazing. I don't know why. Even parents who aren't Christians want you to baptize their kids. They want it. And so, okay, come to the class and what Todd's describing. So we're sharing the gospel. So if you can just find any kind of thing that's going on in your neighborhood where you can get into the regular rhythm of what they're doing, and you can offer some kind of a class that really turns into a gospel conversation, that's the bottleneck, because they're putting themselves into it. You're not having to beg them. They want to do it. Pre-marriage is awesome for that. Marriage counseling is awesome for that. Doing a funeral for a family that's not connected with your church is awesome for that. Doing a wedding for somebody that's not connected with your church is awesome for that. Think about all the bottleneck conversations that people are begging you to have. And if you'll just have them, they're right there for you.
Yeah, and I think it's just a helpful thing to see how even this was born out of a bottleneck conversation, and hopefully this is helpful to you, and that you figure out what those bottlenecks are. And for some of you, that may mean like leaving General Assembly and thinking, hey, how do we help our kids ministry or our student ministry create some bottleneck conversations? How do we help our small group Bible study teachers maybe do more of this? Like one thing we did, we wrote two devotionals as a team in the past year. I can tell you where to get those if you want, but there's one's called Pursue, and it's kind of like an entry-level Bible study. And we have all these Pursue groups. Well, Pursue is based on Recover and Pursue, God's design. And so the beginning of Pursue for newer Christians or just somebody that's newer to our church, if they like, hey, I'll sign up for a Bible study. I've never been to one of those. It walks them through that. We actually we wrote a Christmas devotional this year, an Advent devotional called Christmas Unraveled. And Christmas Unraveled is pretty much a three circles tool for us, for people that are like, hey, you know what, Christmas time, I'll buy a little devotional to take my family through, and we'll talk about God at that time. There are so many opportunities for you to have bottleneck conversations. So I think you need to consider that and seize that opportunity. Just a couple other quick things, and then we're gonna hear some stories, and I think Bob has some things to share. We've already said this, but involve your student ministry and your children's ministry. Involve your student ministry and your children's ministry. The trainings that you have with your volunteers, make sure they're equipped to have these conversations with the folks that they're serving, those kids, those parents. You probably realize this, for those of you who have kids, when they catch hold of the gospel, they're actually pretty eager to want to share it with others, right? They're willing to do that. And so I would just involve your student ministry, your children's ministry. When we have our camps, like we're about to have our kids camp and then our middle and high school camp, this is something that happens, not only in the devotionals, but as we preach and teach on stage to those kids that come to our camps. We'll probably have around 750 kids that come to our camp this summer. We're giving them this. We're helping them understand this. We're giving them a lens to look at life through that helps them understand the good news of the gospel. And you've already seen how aggressively our world is trying to give our kids a different lens to look through. What this does as a church, it gives us the opportunity to help recenter that and give them a lens while giving them the gospel. So involve your student ministry, your children's ministry, whether it's VBS, your retreats, your mission trips, all that. What we found is that it's just really effective. It's more effective to incorporate evangelistic training in those environments than it is to get people to sign up for a class. If it's infused in your children's ministry, yeah. If it's infused in your student ministry.
Hey guys, I'd just encourage you not to miss this. To me, this is probably the most actual, practical, helpful, and revolutionary thing for evangelism in your church, what Todd just said. So let me give you an example. If I said to my church, hey, Wednesday night for 6 weeks, if you'll show up, we'll make you practice the three circles on each other, and we might even make you go knock on doors and try to share with people you don't know. If we do that, we will have some people show up. Now, three of them are the same three old deacons who've been to every evangelism training for the last 40 years, and they know every method, and I got the whole toolbox by memory. Then there's some other poor saps who haven't been members long enough to realize nobody goes to that, so they show up. And then we try to get them to go out, and we start out with 20 people in the class, and by week three, we got 8 people in the class, and by week eight, we're down to the three deacons. And so, but you know what we've also found? When we say, hey, we were going to have VBS, or we're going to have kids camp, and we're going to need 120 adult volunteers, who signs up to be the adult volunteers at kids camp? It's the sharpest, most eager, young couples, parent-type people in your church. They all sign up for that stuff. And if you say, now look, if you want to be a volunteer at kids camp, you know in the world we live in today, we've got to do training. We've got to background check you. So you're going to have to show up on Saturday from 8 to noon so we can do a training with you. We'll have almost 100% attendance. They're used to it. If you want to volunteer as a baseball coach, you got to do all that stuff. You want to volunteer at the school, you got to do all that stuff. People know that's what you do with kids. So they will all show up. And what do we do for a big segment while we're there? We're doing evangelism training. Now, if I announced, I need the youngest, sharpest couples in our church to show up to do evangelism training on Saturday morning, I'm going to have zero. But if I say, we're going to train you for kids camp, we'll have packed house. And so it's not a matter of, are we doing it? It's using the rhythms of your church that you already have. So if we have a deacon's training, we're going to do three circles. If we train a group to go on a mission trip overseas, they're going to do the three circles. If we take our students on a mission trip, they're going to do the three circles. It's integrating your evangelistic tool into the regular rhythms of your church. Now, we still have our three circles evangelism training, but the way we've trained hundreds and hundreds of people who will never come to that is what I'm telling you right here. So I would just encourage you to consider finding ways to embed it into the regular rhythms and training processes of your church.
Yeah, and I think a big part of it would also be with your staff, kids ministry staff, your student ministry staff. When you leave fired up about this, hopefully you're encouraged to go do this. This may mean you pull them in first for a little, you know, hey, come over. We're going to make some dinner. I want to show you a tool that we're going to try and help train people in our church. And I want you to be at the ground floor because I actually think the most important way for us to get this into the life of the church is through our student ministry and our kids ministry, because it's going to start influencing parents and it's going to actually help us. As I go air war, you're going to help me with the ground war, and we're going to actually change our church to our culture to be more evangelistic. Hopefully a lot of good things happen with that, and you're going to hear some stories. So you see on your paper, number 9, collect stories. I would just encourage you to do that. Have a place where you keep those, where you tell them often. And so we got a couple of them we want to tell you about. So I think we got some pictures coming up of these. And Jimmy, feel free to jump on any of these that you want to. But this one.
I don't know who it is.
I'm trying to remember which one it is. This is Chase Smith.
Oh, yeah.
That was the sports team, wasn't it? They were sharing the gospel with a bunch of people in a weight room.
Yeah.
And so that was just a way for them to drip those conversations. You'll see just a variety of these, that some of them are drawn into the ground, people having conversations at grocery stores and things like that. One of my favorites, I don't have a picture of it. I wish I did. We live in South Florida, which means there's a lot of Spanish-speaking folks from a variety of Latin countries, so a large, large Hispanic population. This is a true thing that happened. Somebody shared the three circles with tortillas, all right? If that's not contextualization, I don't know.
Hey man, my daughter-in-law was sitting at the pool on the Army base in Louisiana last week, and she looked over, and there's a lady sitting next to her on the pool that had the three circles tattooed on her shoulder right there.
Here's one.
Yeah, so, yeah, we've seen a lot of these tattoos.
Yeah, yeah. If anybody wants to get that one, I believe the GA office is going to pay for that this year. So just see stoffer.bob@epc.org. So there's just a variety of great ways for you to do this. I wouldn't recommend doing that on, like, the, you know, where you're going to get arrested. But in our churches, we have it up on the walls. All kinds of ways for us to just, we love collecting these and seeing how other churches use this, and hopefully you're doing the same thing. One thing we ask is, man, if you get some great stories and God does some cool things in your churches, man, tell us about them. We love to hear about this. We love to celebrate with our little family of churches in South Florida. And so as God uses you, man, share those stories with us. And then just finally, we'll wrap with this. It's important to celebrate God's stories. I think we're always fixated on the next thing, right? That when God does something incredible around us, we forget to stop and smell the roses. And I want to just tell you about a couple of these real quick. This is actually one. This is my friend Kimmy. And Kimmy grew up in a Jewish household. Kimmy married a Puerto Rican guy named Danny. They started just getting involved in Palm Beach County life. Saw on Facebook that one of our neighborhood churches, a family church west, was hosting a little picnic, like a cookout with bounce houses for kids and all that. And she comes and she meets one of our pastors, and he asks about her and why they came. And she said, I'm Jewish, I'm not real interested. My husband kind of came from a Christian background, so we're here for the picnic. We don't really, like, that's why we're coming. So Kimmy, on her way out, Joel, our pastor, says, hey, Kimmy, there's actually, you told me where you live. There's actually a family church in your neighborhood. You're probably driving by it all the time. It's called Sherbrooke. It's right around the corner from where you live. And so file that away. 3 months later, it's Easter Sunday. And Danny, because he grew up in Puerto Rico and grew up around Christianity, thought, you know what? It's Easter. We should go to church. So Kimmy comes with Danny, reluctantly, and they're sitting in the middle of the room. I remember meeting them that day, and the person on the right, Jimmy Muir, preaches at our campus. Jimmy, as a part of his Easter Sunday message, talks about the three circles. Starts drawing it out. Hey, so when we talk about the resurrection, Jesus has come to transform lives and change everything, and here's how he does it, and he explains it. And Kimmy, who grew up Jewish, sits there and says, I believe Jesus is the Messiah. And her whole life has changed. We got to baptize her at the beach, and it's awesome to just see that God could do this. And you know, we celebrate this story. We just had parent-child dedication for our kids. We celebrate that God has transformed their families. There's another family from Family Church Gardens, the Scops. And this was a family that came. They wanted to send their kids to our student camp. And that eventually led to the parents having conversations with our pastors. The parents weren't married yet. And so they started having gospel conversations. They felt that conviction. They repented and believed in Jesus. And we got to celebrate their baptism, their marriage, all of that. It kind of influenced every aspect of their church life. There's a guy named Rudy. Rudy is a sheriff, works for the sheriff's department in Palm Beach County. And Rudy's friend Garrett, on the right there, Garrett is one of his fellow sheriff deputies. And Garrett had been having gospel conversations with Rudy all, like, very, very, very often. And he eventually took him through the three circles. And not only did Garrett get to lead Rudy to Christ through using the three circles, but when Rudy went through our baptism class and we let our members participate in it, Garrett got to be one of the people that helped baptize him. No. And there's so many of these stories. And Jimmy, you've been friends with the Dailies a long time. You want to talk a little bit about Hudson and how God has just changed his whole family?
Well, it's just pretty awesome. The Dailies are a family that have, they've been kind of connected with church for a while, but they've really got on fire for Christ in the last few years. And then just watching them raise their children to know Christ and watching them learn how to communicate with one another as a couple, watching them learn how to communicate the gospel to their children, and just seeing Hudson come to Christ and just watching this young guy who's a doctor baptize his son and the joy on his son's face and the joy on his face. It's really a lot of fun. I know some of you are like, yeah, it's because you guys don't do baptism right. That's why you have all that fun. You're not doing it right. And I understand because, so I have a friend named David Nichols. David Nichols had planted a lot of, he was a Presbyterian, planted a lot of churches all over America. He was the pastor of a church. He planted a church called Spanish River Presbyterian Church in South Florida. Great, great, great church. He's a great pastor and a great mentor in evangelism for me. And I remember David and I were having, we had lunch at Chili's where business happens about 4 days before he died and went to heaven. And so we're sitting there at Chili's, and David goes, you know what I'm jealous about you for? What, David? Baptism. He goes, if I could believe in it, I would do it. You guys have such a hook. I mean, when somebody gets saved, we like give them a high five. When they get saved with you guys, you got another thing for them to do, and you got a whole thing. And so David used to talk about this. So we do use baptism a lot. But the thing of it is, and I know you guys use baptism in a similar way when someone becomes a believer in Jesus. But whatever you can do to celebrate and highlight and publicly rejoice, and whatever you can do to involve the people who were instrumental in bringing that person to Christ is really important. Because if you reserve all of the cool stuff for the clergy, then what you end up with is all the pros end up doing all the work and all the Joes think they're not worthy. And if there is a way, and I don't understand all your polity and I don't know all your theology, so I'm not trying to, you know, do everything right. But if there are ways you can connect and involve as many people as possible who are with them on the journey in a public way, it's amazing how motivating and exciting that can be. And I would just try to, you do you and find a way to get more. If kids are involved leading teenagers to Christ, let those teenagers somehow be involved in the public celebration of a new believer. Let children be involved. Let a mom be involved with her daughter or her girlfriend from the neighborhood or whatever. Let these people be involved, because if they get to celebrate, man, you're going to reproduce more of what you celebrate. And if their perception is, you know, we're just the cats, and we come to our pastors and elders with the rats and drop them at their feet, and then they take it from there, that's not a really good way to run a church, is it? Because we have an ocean of lostness, yes or no? There are not enough professionals to get it done. The only way that you are going to move the needle in your neighborhood, in your community, in your city, is if you have scores or hundreds or thousands or tens of thousands of EPC people turning everyday conversations into gospel conversations. You've got to have thousands upon thousands engaged. And if you have thousands of people doing it, you will end up with millions of gospel conversations. And God will use His word, His gospel, to save when His people throw their net out one more time. And that's the name of the game for all of this. It really is.
I want to tell you about some folks that threw their net out.
Tell me.
We'll wrap with this. So this is our most recent. This was actually last Sunday, our beach baptism we had. And I love this picture because it's...
Because Jesus is in it.
Because, yeah, the Lord is in the back. I'll tell you about him in a second. So on your left is a guy named Michael. So Michael was invited to our church through a young pharmacy student at Sherbrooke named Joshua. Joshua brought like six or seven of his pharmacy buddies. They all sit together at church, and so I've started to call them our drug dealers. And so Joshua brought these guys, and Joshua started having conversations with Michael through pharmacy school, through what they're going through, started talking to Michael about the gospel. And Joshua got in the water with me, and we got to baptize his friend together who repented and believed in Jesus. Those two children right there, Elena and Emilio, their mom and dad are followers of Jesus, came from a Lutheran background, had never really connected there, and so they wanted to get baptized, become member of our church, and it was because those two kids went through our kids' New Believers class, and they're like, man, our kids really understand the gospel. They're explaining it to us when we get home, and I think this is where we want to plant our flag. We want to be a part of your church, and so we got to celebrate them. In the back, the guy who looks like Jesus, his name is E.J. McDivitt. E.J., went through incarceration, went through some pretty difficult things in his life. He's on the other side now, working as an electrician, but dealing with a ton of brokenness. Well, bottleneck conversation, first connection. One of our deacons, a guy named Gary, was sitting there, because first connection, we put a table host, just some of our everyday folks at those tables, and Gary is sitting with EJ during the break, and he goes back over the three circles again, and EJ says, man, I've been here a long time. Here's where the path it took me, and this has been super difficult for me. And what Gary said is, well, man, you know, some of that can start to change today. I want to invite you. You just heard all this stuff about the gospel. I want to invite you to repent and believe in Jesus. And God was working on his heart, and he did that. And we took him out there, and Gary, my 75-year-old deacon, got out in the water with me, and we baptized EJ together.
Yeah.
Listen, it's happening. It can happen in your churches. You're going to have so many of these stories, and I can't wait to hear about those. Our challenge is, man, don't be like Annalise and look over at Cade and defer responsibility. Take responsibility. Take ownership of the opportunity that God has given your churches, and let's all cast our nets one more time. Pastor Bob?
Well, thanks so much to Todd and Jimmy. Just a couple of other quick things. Let me make it even a little bit more personal for some of us in this room. I've been in lots of churches, as you all know, and been in lots of session meetings, and there have been times when I am fully convinced that the elders around the room do not know how to share the gospel. At the very least, the desire to be missional and evangelical ought to be a qualifying factor for elders in the life of the church. And I've actually had a situation where I said, we got into this conversation, and I said, well, let's just try this out. You got 3 minutes, share the gospel, go. Nothing. All right, you share the gospel. The whole way around the room, had a couple of attempts at personal testimonies. But here's the thing. If we don't have missional pastors, and we don't have missional elders, we will not lead missional churches. And if we don't have evangelistic pastors and evangelistic elders, we will not lead evangelistic churches. And that's on us. That's got to change in our culture. That's how we will create an evangelistic culture denominationally. We can't lead from a place where we're not at personally. So I offer that as a challenge to all of us. By the way, there are resources produced by Family Church for student ministry and children's ministry and all kinds of things. There is also an app that you can get on your phone. So if you go to your app thing, What, you think I can't tell about it? Are you saying I can't
I know you're technologically gifted. All right, so if you have the App Store, if you search Life on Mission, there's an app there that will walk you through this. It includes a lot of Bible verses and some additional video resources. If you're an Android user, there's a very simplified app that if you just search for Three Circles in your Google Play Store. But our hope is in the future, those are just two resources. Our hope is in the future that it's built in either to your EPC app or you guys create one, and that's the beauty of open source. I hope that you'll take it and run with it. And if you've got people that are good at that kind of thing, go for it. If you go to NAM's website, the North American Mission Board, their website, you can buy student ministry kits and kids ministry kits and these things that you're seeing. These life conversation guides, you can get those in English and Spanish and Portuguese on their website. And so those resources are all available to you if they're helpful.
And the importance of celebrating, if you go to a family church, there will not be a week go by that they're not showing these videos celebrating baptisms. This celebrating stories is so important. And the other thing we found is our coordinators have begun to talk about this. This bottleneck thing is so super important, so practical and helpful. Look for every reason to be able to create a situation in your church that creates a bottleneck that your people have to move through and make sure that you share them. So thanks for that, for Jimmy and Todd. We're going to have a couple people just share today. I think they're both here. Mark Farrell and Mark DeJay. Is Mark here? Mark, yep. Come on, both you guys come up. I'm going to have Mark share a little bit about some of the things he's been experiencing as the coordinator in Florida. And then Mark DeJay is going to share a little bit about how we take this to the next level in our presbyteries in terms of sharing the things that we're doing in Three Circles. So thanks to Mark is the coordinator of the Alleghenies Presbytery, which we all know is the best.
Well, since training in February, I came back and said to myself, how in the world are we going to get this information out to our church and also presbytery? And what has been so, what I've been so thankful about is the national team. They have just been encouraging us every step of the way till a point where I felt like I got on autopilot as far as getting excited. And so we prepared a slide to share at presbytery on that day I shared at presbytery, Dean Weaver was there, and Dean Weaver said just about every single thing that was on my slide. And so I got up afterward and I said, hey, what he said. But I was able to just reinforce what Dean had already said, and that just kind of gave me more confidence to share it with our church. During Eastertide season, I was preaching through 1 Corinthians 15, and the first four verses, Paul's talking about the gospel. Well, in that particular sermon, I'm like, man, I really want to share the Three Circles in this sermon, but I didn't want to force things. So I went back to chapter 2 of Everyday Conversations into Gospel Conversations, and Jimmy tells that story when he was in the Philippines, and he did not share the gospel properly, and Bob Tebow, you know, kind of jumped him a little bit. And so I was able to share that story with our congregation, and that kind of got the conversation started. And so on Pentecost Sunday, I preached through Acts 8 and Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch. And so remember, the Ethiopian eunuch is reading Isaiah 53, and then what does Philip say? Do you understand what you're reading? Well, unless someone shows me, he's reading Isaiah 53, and I'm like, ha-ha. Now it's time for us to put the Three Circles in and make the scenario when you're speaking to someone and they want to know what the Bible is talking about, or they want to know more about the gospel, here is a tool that got me back in the game, and it's going to get you back in the game as well. So I'm thankful to the Lord for the momentum that's taking place in our church, the momentum that's taking place in our presbytery, and look forward to sharing in those stories in the future.
Thanks, Mark. So in the Alleghenies, we've had the benefit of Bob's leadership for the past 79 years. For a while. Since before the Alleghenies was the Alleghenies. So the idea of an evangelistic culture that's so deeply you can see in this man's heart And so me stepping into this role with Bob at the national level, and along with Jimmy and Todd and the folks coming to kind of just inspire us, and really the open source, it's they're serious about that. It's open source. They want us to contextualize this. So all the denominational jokes aside, like, it is meant to be able to be used in a way that your church can actually use for the sake of the kingdom. When we have had the opportunity to start to develop some infrastructure already in creating an evangelism team that is a part of our church development committee in our presbytery, and that team, we had a session just like this one back in November, some follow-up conversations at presbytery meetings, and we now have churches reaching out to our team. So for your church, for your congregation, you have most likely a coordinator, a church health coordinator. If you want to just run with this as a church, run with it. But if you know you need a little help, that's what we are here for. So reach out to them. When we've had churches reaching out to us, and we've probably had six now at this point, saying, hey, can you come train us? It usually starts with this. Can you train us to do evangelism? To which the first thing we say is, we definitely want to do that. Can we have another conversation first? Because doing evangelism is an activity. Becoming evangelistic is an identity. We want that culture to be the thing that happens. And so far we've had a couple of those opportunities. And when we talk about that difference between simply doing evangelism, teaching people to go out and articulate the truth of our faith, and that the church would itself become a place in which good news isn't just spoken, the church itself is good news. And the people who come out of it are good news in the local neighborhood. It is a place of good news. And so a way to think about what that eventually could look like, we have one church in our presbytery, and they've been a part of this kind of development of culture for a long time. Their pastor was telling me about a recent session retreat. And the session retreat was on a Friday, Saturday. The Saturday was kind of the meeting time, the prayer time, the planning time. The Friday before was a time for family, friends, and people in their circle to be able to come and just spend time celebrating together, have a cookout together, just enjoy time together, pray together, sing together. One of the people who was a part of this, their staff team, was a young man about 18 years old who had some caseworkers, some wraparound support. This man did a little bit of cleaning around the church, but he got to come because he was a part of the staff and the leadership there in that specific work. So one of the guys who came was a guy, one of his caseworkers, never been to church, you know, had heard about Jesus, but no other experience than that. And in the course of this cookout, in the course of this time singing together, he shared with one of the people in a breakout session where they were going to pray together. He said, the energy here, I don't know what you guys have, but the energy here, there's something. I love this energy. Kept using that language, the energy here. And then the person leading the conversation said, hey, we're going to pray now. And the person said, I've never prayed before. And she said, just say, dear God, and start talking. So here's the point. An evangelistic culture is one in which even your session retreat is an evangelistic opportunity for gospel conversation, right? We want to see this develop from the inside out. And so the tools are meant to bless us, but the work of developing that culture, that's why the coordinators are here, and the structure that we built is meant to build that up for you. So please reach out to your coordinators to begin these conversations to move in that direction together.
Thanks, Mark and Mark. One last advertisement. We discovered not too long ago that evangelism was not mentioned on the EPC website. Now, I thought, there's a problem, right? We're the Evangelical Presbyterian Church. So we have changed that, but changed it, I think, in a very helpful way from the stuff you've heard this morning, in that if you now go to our website and go under what we do, guess what will pop up first? Evangelism. And under that is kind of an explanation of how we have contextualized this in our language. And in our culture. So there's a very good explanation of how it works and why we do it and the background information. So you can see all that on the website, epc.org, if you've never been there. And then under that is a presentation of Jimmy doing the three circles. So it's now on our website. You can see that. So, and by the way, there are, if you just, we talked about Googling Three Circles in 3 minutes. But if you just Google Three Circles, there's all kinds of background videos on this. Jimmy, other people teaching it, taking the material, parsing it. You know, again, we're Presbyterians. We gotta beat it to death. We can't just use it. So there's all kinds of resources on there for background and all of that. So I encourage you to go to the website and do that. One housekeeping item, we'd love for you to take the books that you have. If at your table would like you to leave the books that remain, we have other uses for them throughout the assembly and for our coordinators. But finally, to Mark's point, please find your coordinator, who is the coordinator of your presbytery. Be an encouragement to them. Be a support to them. Pray for them. How can we help? How can we be a part of what you're doing? How can we show you the ways that God's at work here and help you to be more effective in what you're doing in the life of your church? So, is Doug here? That would be a no. Okay. Here's my understanding of what will happen. And we do invite you to come to us, to come to our time for the lunch, which Jimmy will be sharing. Tom Ricks will be asking some church planting questions. We're going to ask some church health questions and have an opportunity for you to hear what's God doing around the country, how do we create an evangelistic culture, what could we do as the EPC to become more evangelistic in our culture. So we're hopeful you'll come for that panel discussion. I think it'll be super helpful and exciting. And my understanding is what we will do is that lunch, if I could see past the lights, is that Doug? No. Okay. What I understand we're doing is for lunch, the people in this room will go out this way, and our lunches are in the hall back here. And then other people, there will be more people joining us for lunch. And so they'll be coming in from this way. So if you're in the room now, your lunch is behind us. Others will go, and then we'll be back here to start our time together for the panel discussion, and hope that you'll join us for that. Would you please give a hand to Jimmy and Todd again for what they're doing? And maybe in the next couple minutes, just around your table, what's next? What has this spurred in me? What do I do next to do that?
At 10:20.